All right, how's everybody doing this morning? Good. Enjoying the event?
Yeah.
All right. So I guess I'll start off with a little about myself. My name's Paul Bevins. I'm a certified Christian apologist through crossexamine.org. I also am attending school and a bunch of other things and all that jazz on these topics as well. So before we begin, let's just start with a quick prayer, and then we'll get into it. Right. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for who you are and for all that you do for us. Lord, thank you for your son and for the many blessings that it is to know him. Lord, please bless this meeting. Help me to speak well. And Lord, help everybody in here to learn from it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I have a different method. I like the Socratic method, which is a really long way of saying I like asking a lot of questions. Okay, so if you spend any time with me, after about 20 minutes in, I'll be asking you who, what, where, when, why, how. Because it's just how I do things. So how many people here own a Bible? Show your hands. Great. What is the Bible? God's word, right? What does the, in Scripture, it says that the Bible is good for, let me get my notes up now that my iPad closed. Right, I'll quote 2 Timothy 3. All Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. In Psalms, I'm going to quote Psalms 1:2 after Brett, and it's the talking about the righteous man. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. So if it's any of these things that we think it is there anything more important that we could study? No. How many of you have been taught how to study your Bible? Got one, right? I wasn't up until a couple years ago. So the reason that I asked this question is, what is the Bible? Now, it is God's word, right? But what is it in reality? It's actually 66 books covering six different topics. It covers prophecy, poetry, wisdom, gospel, letters. Covers a lot of different things. Do you read history the same way you read poetry? No. You shouldn't read Psalms the same way you read Chronicles. You're not going to get the same information out of it that you should. This is very, very important. So the Old Testament was actually completed around 430 BC by the Italian prophet Malachi. Malachi, right? So 430 BC was when the Old Testament was finally closed. At the end of 430 BC, you have a 400-year period of silence, which then results in the beginning of the New Testament from Matthew, Mark, which is considered the earliest gospel, which was written around 35 to 40, until the end of Revelation, which was written around 68 AD, just before the destruction of the temple. So you have a 4,000-year period of time that's covered in Scripture. This is important. Sorry, I thought somebody was asking a question. So the reason this is important is that we have a biblical timeline, okay, of what all of these things are and how they all interrelate together. So I won't go into too much detail about the history. If you want more information, let me know. I can recommend. There's a bunch of books on it. But it's good to know the history. And one thing I always find really, really interesting is to go through and actually hold up biblical history along with world history and see where everything aligns and where it intersects. It's just really kind of neat. So for instance, who here has heard of Plato? Okay, Plato would have been a contemporary of Jeremiah. Jeremiah and Plato lived at the same time in history. Just kind of cool. So I won't get into any more history, but there's one thing that I want to ask you guys. When were the chapters and verses added? How many knew that the chapters and verses were added? They weren't original, right? Chapters and verses were added around the 16th century, purely for the sake of reference. You use the chapter and verses so that when I'm up here and I'm talking, I can say, oh, I'm in 2 Timothy 3, verse 14. So you can all go through, figure out where I am. What they're not are individual thoughts. some of the chapters are in the wrong spots. And I'll get into that later, into how you can know that they're not necessarily in the right spots. And the big thing is modern writing. At the end, when we do modern writing, what does a chapter do for us? Closes our thought, right? We're ending a thought and beginning a new thought. This isn't how biblical literature was written. It was written with the intent to be one cohesive whole. If somebody writes you an email, are you only going to read the second paragraph? Probably not. Because I'll give you an example of why we shouldn't do that. When you get a strike, your team will celebrate. What am I talking about? Baseball, volleyball, bowling, let's think, oil, gold, silver. I could be talking about anything. It's only when you know what the context is that you're going to be able to know what I'm talking about. So there's three rules. What are the three rules of real estate? Location, 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 right? So the three rules of biblical interpretation are context, context, context. Where is it? Who's it talking to? And why is it there? So you remember those three rules, which are pretty easy because they're all the same rule. You will get rid of most of the bad biblical interpretation that's out there. You have to be very, very careful, right? So everybody with me? All right. So I have some handouts up here. The reason I didn't hand them out is because it had my three rules on it. So I'll hand them out after. But they're on here. I have these two acronyms. You can write them down if you want to, or you can just come up to me later and I can give you a copy of the paper. So the first acronym I want everybody to remember is CRIME: Creation, Rebellion, Intervention, Mission, and Eternity. This is the biblical narrative in one acronym. At the beginning, we had creation. We had Adam and Eve, the fall, right? That was rebellion. From rebellion, these two points cover the book of Genesis and part of in most of Exodus, right? Then we run into the intervention, the I. This is God's intervening on behalf, in this sense, in the biblical story. Intervention covers from the end of Exodus up through the end of Malachi. Right, that's the intervention period. Then you have the instance of mission, right? Intervention runs all the way up through the time of Christ. We run into mission now, which is where we are, right? We should be on mission in this instance after having known who Christ is, and all of this eventually leads to eternity, right? So this is the biblical narrative in five words, or five letters. Why is that important to know? Well, if we take a book and we're studying it, we're trying to understand, where does this fit in the biblical narrative? What's the point, right? Well, if we know we're in the beginning of the intervention period, we know this is prior to Christ. This is the law. This is that era of where, all right, he's intersecting with the law, right? What's the point? What's the why? Okay? The second acronym is even more important. Whenever you open your Bible and you're going to begin reading, I want you to stop. Situation, type, object, prescription or description. Okay, so I'm gonna take a couple sections and we're gonna go through and look at this, right? So the first one, I'll back up a second. I heard a question recently from a guy by the name of J.P. Moreland. And J.P. Moreland, if you don't know who he is, he teaches. He's a professor and a theologian. He's also a pastor. He asked this question. When cults, Jehovah's Witnesses, or Mormons come to his door, they knock on his door, he opens the door, and he says, all right, I'll talk with you in this sense, and we can have, if you can tell me why you take Scripture out of context. And they say, oh, we don't take Scripture out of context. He's like, all right, name the theme of one book of the Bible. What's the theme of it? And in the book, he said, if you can't do this, your way to studying Scripture is probably inadequate. If you are a Christian for any period of time, and you're going through and you're reading your Bible, which we all should be doing, if we can't tell what the theme of one book is, our way of studying the Bible is inadequate, and we need to change it. And that's what these acronyms will help us do. That they get us on the start of how to do this correctly, right? All right, so let's take our Bibles and open to Philippians 4:13. Okay, so this is the part where hopefully everybody doesn't take me out back and stone me. Okay, so we're going to get my Bible out here. So everybody's probably heard this verse used, especially at baseball games and a lot of other stuff, right? So 1 Philippians 4:13, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. What's the context of this verse? Contentment, right? But you know the prior part of the verse, right? This is similar in the situation of what I said before. When you get a strike, your team will celebrate. So let's go through the STOP acronym. All right, what's the situation? Well, Paul is writing to the church of Philippians, really, and he's relating out, look, this is what the Christian life looks like. This is, you know, it's going to result in this, and this is how, and this is why. And we get to the point in Philippians where he talks about, I rejoice greatly, this is starting in verse 10. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you have no opportunity. But you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. That gives context to that statement, to where it doesn't lose its meaning when we add the context, but actually has greater meaning, and makes the statement that when we use this at football games, wrong. We actually cheapen Scripture when we do this, and we shouldn't do it. We need to be very careful when we act in that way and in that manner, right? So this is that. So the situation, right, with Philippians, Paul is writing to the church in Philippi, you know, explaining what's going on, these kind of things. What type of literature is the book of Philippians? It's epistle. It was written with the intent to a specific person, right? So, type's epistle. And then, who's the object of the passage? Who's he talking to? Well, he's talking to the people of Philippians, or of Philippi. Do we know anything about Philippi? Can we even point at it on a map? No, we should. Look, we live in the information age. You want to know where Philippi is? As soon as I find my phone. Right? It's in Greece. That's where it is. We can open it up. We can look at it. We can figure out, all right, look, what was going on? What was the area? I recently just did a study in Colossians. And in my study in Colossians, I started going through and looking at it and doing some study. And what I ended up finding out is that Colossians and Ephesians were written at the same time from the same jail cell, delivered by the same person. If you have a question in Colossians, go to Ephesians. You can open them up and read them side by side, and some of the same topics are covered. So it's Paul restating his ideas in a different way. All this does for us is when we read Scripture with this idea of addressing the context as a whole, it makes Scripture have more meaning and actually stops us from doing bad context. Right? How many people have heard people use bad Scripture, pulling Scripture out of context? Look, I my history is a little checkered in that way, is that I moved 22 times before I was 22. We moved all over the place. My mom was originally Baptist, got into the full gospel movement, then got into non-denominational, so there was a whole bunch of different stuff all the way through. I have heard pastors and people use verses out of context. It's not a good thing because it gives a bad example. So here's an example from preaching. Christ, even this morning, he didn't go out of context in this sense, but what he did is this. Christ got to the end of the book and said, "Peace be still." And he said, and all of nature responded and quieted down. I'm sitting there, amen. Because the other version I've heard of that is Christ will calm the storms in your life. Yes, but not from that passage. That's not the point. The point of that passage is to demonstrate that Christ is God over all. He is the God of nature in this instance, to show that he is who he said he was. Now, God will work with us and help us with the problems in our life. And we can get that from many other scriptures, but we shouldn't pull it from this one. That's not the point. Everybody with me? All right. So the last one, this is, as we talked, situation, type, object. This is the biggest one. Prescription or description? Is it prescribing something we should do, or is it describing an event? David with Bathsheba. Everybody here know the story? David went up to the top of, he should have been at war, right? David went up to the top of his palace, looked out from the top, and saw a woman bathing. So firstly, he's not where he should be, because he should be out leading the army. Second point is then he ends up having relations with her, killing her husband, right? And then to try and cover everything up. Prescribing something we should do or describing a past event? Describing, right? It's describing something that has occurred. That's the important point, is that it's history, right? It's describing what has already happened. Another one in this sense is David kills Goliath. What's the point of the story? What's the why? What's the context? Once again, we're dealing with history. It's relating Jewish history. It is not relating. It's relating that God can use even small men to accomplish his will. It does not mean that God will help us slay the giants in our lives. That's not what the verse is talking about. It doesn't mean that God doesn't, but we have to be careful when we do this, because if we begin down this track of taking verses, ripping them of their context, and using them, we do two errors. The first error is we turn this into a book of spells. That's what we do. We stand there. I did this as a kid, and now I'm horrified. Open it up, flip back and forth. God's word for me today. Well, thankfully, I never arrived at Jeremiah 44:11, which was, I will destroy you. You know, but that's the thing. Well, then go back and forth. Well, I don't like that one. Try again. Right? The second thing we do is we begin a process of small errors can result in big problems. If you're trying to sail from New York to England and your compass is off by 2 degrees, will you ever arrive? No. You'll be lost at sea. Even a small degree of difference over a long period of time results in a big change of direction. Why we must be very, very careful when we get into studying scripture. So, all right, what's the first acronym? Test time. What's the second acronym? Whenever we read our Bibles, we should first stop. Take a few minutes. Think about it. What's going on? What's the point? Who's he talking to? These are very, very important things. Because when we pause and we do this, yes, this takes effort. But look, most things do. Is being married and having a family easy? No, following Christ isn't easy. He actually said, pick up your cross, which in that time meant a lot more to us than it does now. The word cross, the word excruciating, literally means from the cross in Greek. It was such a wretched amount of pain that they gave it a new word. Right? So this is what it means to walk with Christ, is a life of sacrifice, as Brett mentioned. You know, it's Romans 12:2. Be living sacrifices in this sense. Effort, exercise. How many of us in this situation, if it wasn't for people throughout our lives looking at us and encouraging us to do, hey, look, you need to stay in school. You need to do these things. You need to do this. You need to buck up. We'd be in the situation of probably not being anywhere where we should be. These things weren't easy, but they were still good. So it brings me around to this in this point. I got a few minutes left. So first thing I would recommend that you all do is look. when you read, if you're going to read for devotions and you just want to read quickly, go to the Psalms. Seriously, there's Psalms of any length you want. You have 150 Psalms, and in those Psalms you have prophecy, history. You have everything you could want in a small Psalm. It's great for devotions. If you're going to make your way through the epistles and these kind of things, take 10 minutes, go online, find a YouTube video of the guy reading the entire book. Listen to the entire book from start to finish so that you have an idea of what's going on in the book. It's like Brett mentioned, go online, find it being read. It's a good way. It's what I do because I wake up, I get dressed, I go to work, I throw something on, and that's what I do. I listen while I'm driving. Then I get home and I try and read. You know, depending upon how the day goes, you know how that works. But it's that way of be intentional in your understanding. So last thing I want to tell you guys, and this one I don't have on here, but you should write down. Look for transition words. So a transition word is where a thought is continued or expounded upon. And this can be really phrased up by this one line. What's the therefore, therefore? Why is there a therefore there? Because it means he's actually talking about a prior thought. The other words are for, so, but, wherefore. These are all words that are calling back to an idea already presented. Everybody with me? Okay. In end, this book is the Word of God. It is the point at which it's good. It's how we know how to live to please Him. There is nothing that we could do as a study that's more important than this book. We need to handle it with care in the situation of make sure that we know what we're reading, why we're reading it, and what its point is. If you do these few things, you'll get rid of about 95% of bad interpretation. It just takes time and effort. I guess in this sense, questions, comments, thoughts from anybody? Or I can, rotten fruit, by the way. Yeah. Thank you. No, it's, I wasn't trained on, when I was a kid going through and reading and doing different things, it always bothered me that, all right, this doesn't say that. How can we get this? And it wasn't up until a few years ago that I actually went through a course that showed me, all right, look, this is what you need to do to actually do it well. Well, then after doing it, you're going through and you're reading, going, whoa, that doesn't mean that. Well, now we have a whole new world. And the joy of this is, in this way, is that this doesn't cheapen scripture study. It actually makes it a whole lot better. Because it's actually in this situation of, look, what Paul meant for you to get out of it is there. Spend the time and actually do the research into it. What were they addressing? What were the problems? What's the why? You know, one of the funnest things I did was I went on and, in my study of Colossians, I pulled up an old map. Figured, all right, what was going on in Colossians? Where was it in relation to Ephesians? You know, well, you had to travel through Ephesus to get to, or you had to travel through Colossae to get to Ephesus. It's like, oh, okay, well, that's why you wrote both of them. It was because the guy took a ship, went there, and traveled up to Ephesus. You know, so it's just cool to put it in that sense of, all right, look, how far did they travel? What was going on in the area? We have records. You know, Colossae was where they had the Colossus, which was the statue that was huge statue that was by the bay. You know, it connects to history in this sense, and you can look at it and get these ideas. All right, what was he talking about? When Paul was in Athens and marched up Mars Hill, and he made this statement, God does not live in temples. This was said in front of the Parthenon, the temple to the goddess Athena, which is where they got the word Athens from. You know, so what he said at that time to all the people standing there was like, what? You know, we look at it and go, well, of course gods don't dwell in temples, you know, because we have years of history in this sense. And thankfully, Christian instruction, knowing that gods don't live in temples, we are the temple, right? But when we have this historical context for it, man, scripture just, you're like, wow. You know, you talk about daring. You know, well, that'd be the equivalent of walking across the street from the mosque and doing the same thing. You know, I'm saying it's a daring thing that these guys did. Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Most certainly. Well, if you do even ancient Israel. Look, ancient Israel spent 40 years in a desert that we can still look at from Google Earth. That desert hasn't changed, because you want to know why? It's pretty barren, man. There's not a lot there. Well, and that's just it. You get these ideas. All right, what was going on? What was happening? So the entire Exodus, right? So in the entire Exodus, they've done some research. And if you want more information on biblical history, I recommend Walter Kaiser's book, A History of Israel. And it covers all this, and he goes through and he talks about the Pharaoh that would have likely been there when Moses came back. The Pharaoh would have been young, extremely accomplished militarily, right, and was the leader of the ancient world superpower. So when this old 80-year-old dude walks in and says, "Let my people go," the Pharaoh went, "Ha! Yeah, no. Not going to happen." You know, but then you go through, and this is the interesting point, is that Egyptian history is pretty much one king after the other king after the other king. These are their doings, these are their doings, these are their doings. Except when you get to this guy, there's a 20-year gap. Nothing is written down from the Egyptian perspective for 20 years. Why? Well, because in their culture, they would not have recorded when this guy failed, because this man was like a god king. You know, so it's just these things that when you're going through and you're reading, look, this stuff, it, all of a sudden you're like, okay, this is pretty cool. You know, because then you're, all right, you have this, and you have this, you have this. You know, but it takes effort. And the beautiful thing about these is it doesn't take nearly as much effort as it used to. You know. Coming to the end of my time, but I got time for a couple more questions. If you got, oh, go for it. I recommend so when it comes to in-depth Bible study, three. Get three translations. I use the NASB, the NIV, and the King James from time to time. I grew up reading the King James, so for me, I the King James Poetic Language is what I use. But if you're going to get one for study, go with the NASB or the NIV. I prefer the NASB, but this one right here is the NIV. It's sometimes easier for its relation to English is a little better. If you guys want Bible study tools, like I said, three translations, a good Bible dictionary. Get a good Bible dictionary that'll go through. If you don't know a word, look it up. Seriously, I have people throw words at me all the time that I don't know. The best thing I can do is go, all right, what does that word mean? I don't know what that word means. Well, now I do. You know, so just take the time, do the effort, do the work. You know, he comes across a good Bible atlas that you can get online, and one of the best is a good commentary. A good commentary on Scripture, so that when you go through and you're reading and you come to a part you don't know, look, that's when you use the commentary. It's not meant to replace Bible reading, but it's meant to support Bible reading, much like vitamins are meant to support exercise. They don't replace exercise, they just help it. You know, so when you do that, and good commentary that I like is called the Bible Knowledge Commentary. It was written by a couple guys, one of them being Norman Geisler, who I personally really, really like, Norman Geisler. But that'd be my recommendation in that sense.
You really got to be careful with some of the versions and help them, because it really, some of them really change the meaning around when they translated it.
Yeah, definitely. So if you think of a spectrum, like, so if you have a line here, right? So you have as close to language as we, word for word language as we can get to purely interpretation on it. You have right here about the best one that I know of is the New American Standard Bible, the NASB. You have the NIV, which is right about here, and then King James is right about there as well. And then when you get over here, you have the Message, and then whatever the most recent one is, I forget what it's called. Something else. Just avoid those ones. Go with the ones that like the NASB, the NIV, those kinds. Those are good. Where some of the other, even the Living Translation is somewhere in the middle. That's a good translation too. But when you get to the Message and some of the other ones, that it's just purely, this is what I think it means. Well, this is what I think it means. It doesn't actually mean that. You know. Well, once again, we come back to what are the three rules for biblical interpretation? Context. It's all about context. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Well, that's the thing is that when if we that's right in the area of apologetics, which is where I love talking about. All right, why do we believe the Bible is the Word of God? Which is sadly not something I can cover in 3 minutes. in that sense, there's some really good works on that on why we believe it's the inspired Word of God, why we believe it's inerrant, and those kind of things. There's a lot of good works out there on that. On the bottom of these papers, I'll actually hand these out real quick. I have my email. You just want to take one and pass it along. If there's not enough, just please take a copy of, a picture of it and stuff. Sure. That'd be perfect. Thank you very much, Brett. And that's like Chris, that's the thing is there's, yes, if you understanding the fundamentals of your faith and why we believe what we believe is literally the most important thing you'll ever do. Why do you believe that Christ is the Son of God, that he came and died and rose again for us, is the most important question you'll ever ask in your life. There's nothing more important than that. Yep. Well, and that's the thing is what the purpose of the Spirit really in that sense is to help us to learn in this sense to test, right? To know when something is off. So now the more you go about reading and learning to read in context and learning to read this way, the deeper and more meaning it'll have. It just takes time and effort. Any other questions? Comments? Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Well, then I guess since we're coming to the end here, we're going to be going for lunch, let me just finish out with some prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for all that you are for us and all that you do. Lord, please help all of us learn to read the Bible better so that we can come to know you in a more complete and better way. Lord, there is nothing more important than knowing you and knowing why you came to save us. Lord, please be with us with the rest of this day. Bless the work of our hands and help us to honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,